Today I spent a bit of time in the shop doing some experimenting with friction welding. And out of this, I learned a lot of new knowledge, new to me at least, that I'd like to pass on to you. The process is really simple, in fact. But there's a few key factors that we need to come down to. But I digress. You're going to need two mating surfaces. And in this experiment, I did a mating surface that has a dimple in the middle on purpose. This will become very evident as I start to friction weld the two pieces of metal together. You're going to see that they're going to start to walk around and kind of dodge each other a little bit. The little dimples aren't too big of a deal if it's really rigid, because eventually those two little dimples are going to wear off and it's actually going to lap the two faces even together. And of course, in the meantime, like I already said, you're going to see it walk everywhere but where you want it to be. In this experiment, I'm just going to go for gusto. I'm just going to slam it together, put a bit of horsepower to it, and just automatically friction weld it together. Notice how it kind of wobbles around as I'm pushing really hard while it's cold. Clearly you can see it unevenly mushroom as the two surfaces are pushed together, spitting out just to one side, making this not such a straight weld. And you're not going to be very happy with this, because not only is it not going to be straight, it's also not going to hold together very well, and with minimal force, it'll snap apart. But hang on, we're going to do this a few times, and each time I do this, we're going to learn a little bit more until we figure out exactly what we're going to need to do the welding. The next idea that immediately popped into mind is, hey, you know what, it's walking around, I'll make a 60 degree cone on this, and that's going to stop it from walking around. Let's take a look at this example and figure out what will work and what won't work with this idea. Now keep in mind, all of these experiments are with roughly the same diameter of shafting, but will vary in some of their metal types. But for the first few, we're going to use the same type of metal, which is plain carbon steel, which in theory will give us less problems when it's welding together with heating and cooling and, you know, hardening and all that other stuff. Let's pull this center drill out and let's dry fit it together and see what it's going to look like. I mean, in theory, this should work, right? Now, if you look really close, it looks like I've already tried to weld it, and that's a fact, actually. The extra surface area on the 60 degree really wants to make it hook up. Now, watch as this comes together, and it'll be really obvious why this won't work. Everything seems to be going good at first, and then one side's going to melt off, and then it goes completely off to the side, not really achieving our goal very well. Not to mention, the strength isn't going to hold up for what you want. Let's have a look. Normally I'm not too big of a proponent on hammering stuff on the lathe, but this isn't really taking too much force to break this off. Let's grab another piece of that scrap and throw it in and give it another whirl, but do a different strategy this time. This time we're going to do a bit of a warm-up phase. We're moving a little bit more towards success here. In the end, we do get success. Pay close attention to how it almost wants to take off every once in a while. That's because I'm increasing the friction and feeding it in a little bit on the tailstock. Now you'll see the bluing kind of start to transmit through everything. This is a little bit of what we're looking for. We want to preheat that. Now, this weld didn't really come together as well as we'd really like. Let's take it out, have a look, and then we'll figure out how to do it a little bit better next time, which is going to give us the result we're looking for. We definitely did get the power to it here, because you can see a bit of slippage in the chuck. Now remember, I was kind of teasing it in there and doing a little bit of a warm-up cycle, which actually, in fact, was lapping the faces of the two material and not causing it to run off. This lip's looking a little bit more satisfactory, but it's not quite what we're looking for quite yet. Let's take it outside and give it the ultimate test. Now notice that it is bending a little bit before this snaps off. Let's do a little bit more of a warm-up cycle and kind of tease it in and out and get a bit more of a mash together. This is going to be a bit more of a success of exactly what we're looking for. Now, I figure if I can bend this over at a 90 degree, it's going to stand up to whatever I need to put on it later on down the road. I would call this partially a success. Now, let's grab a grade 8 bolt and do it exactly the same way. I didn't show you on camera cutting the head of the bolt off because I'm sure you've seen that before, but let's take a special look at the preheat cycle that I'm going to do in this successful one. Now, like I said already, I'm going to bring those two faces in after it laps together, and I'm going to do a really good preheat cycle. The key here is, I'm at least going to heat it up once or twice red hot, and then I'm going to back it off real quick just before it starts to grab. Now, notice that the shaft is going to start to heat up here a little bit, and the color is going to transmit down the shaft. And all of a sudden, it's going to get really grippy, so you got to be careful. And in this instant, it got a little bit too grippy, and I'm gonna have to pull it apart and actually tap it off. And we're gonna use the same part over again, and we're gonna weld it together. And this time it's gonna work. You see, it's not gonna take too much force to knock this off. And then we're just gonna throw it back in, like I said, and redo this. Let's take a look at the end there. It almost looked like the metal kind of friction welded together, but that's not what we're looking for. Now, the RPM that I'm using on this is anywhere between 1500 and 2500 RPM, and this really does come down to horsepower. This technique is actually, in some modified way, used to weld some of the rocket engines together that fly into space. It's kind of called a friction stir welding. Now, by pushing the two metals together with enough horsepower, something has to give, and it's got to weld together. I mean, how many times have you been using an end mill and you didn't use coolant, and you've got an end mill stuck to something? Now notice how it starts to walk around. See the red that's starting up there? I'm just backing it off as soon as I see it. And then as soon as I can start to feel it feel almost like Play-Doh, I'm gonna really go for gusto, and I'm gonna feed that in there as hard and fast as I can. Let's grab this, give it a spin, make sure it's straight, and then we're gonna take it outside and give it the ultimate test with the hammer. Notice that lip on the overlap. This seems to me that when I get this lip on the overlap, it always works out good and it never really breaks for me. Now, let's throw some aluminum in there and see what happens with that, and I think you're gonna be very surprised. Now, we're gonna use the same technique. We're gonna feed it in, back off, feed in, do a bit of a preheat cycle, except for this time, you're not gonna see it get red hot or blue at all. And the process, surprisingly, is gonna happen a lot faster than you would expect. Hey, if you like this video, now would be a good time to hit that subscribe and like button. It really helps out my channel. It also drives me to make cooler and cooler videos for you, not only to entertain you, but so that we all can learn together. And if you're a shop guy like me, I would absolutely love it if you could throw some comments down below on what experiments you've done with friction welding, and let me know what's going to work for you and what doesn't work. Speaking of what doesn't work, let's take a look at what this is going to do outside when we bend it with the hammer. And then after that, we're going to take another piece of brass, and we're going to throw the brass in this time and find out what happens when we use brass. Surprisingly, the weld looks quite a bit different. But this is going to hold together. Spoiler alert, this is going to work, and it's going to work very well. Aluminum doesn't really like to bend past 45 degrees, in my experience. And that's why I'm going to call this a win. If we take a closer look at it, yes, it is starting to pull apart a little bit, but if we had bent it a straight rod in there, eventually it was going to break somewhere as well. Now, let's take some quarter inch brass, and run it at 1500 RPM using the exact same technique as we used before. Now, notice as I'm lapping the face together. It's not exactly melting together like it wanted to before, it's actually throwing off little flakes of brass if you look really close. And it has a bit of more of a gravelly kind of experience as you're pushing them together. So, like any shop guy, I'm thinking to myself, hey, you know what? This isn't working at 1500 RPM. Let's spin it up to 2500 RPM, because faster is better, right? Well, let's see what happens. And really, I have a really good feeling going into this, but you know what, disappointment alert, it's just going to degrade the metal a lot faster, and I'm not actually going to get the friction welding process happening. Now, I'm not sure exactly why this is the case, and I'm wondering if anybody out there knows why the brass won't melt together, when all the steel and the other alloys will. Hey, I really enjoyed hanging out with you today doing this process, and if you want to see some more of the videos, why don't you click on one of the links up in the top left corner, or my channel in the top right corner, and pick something out that you're going to like. Let's catch you on the next video.